said good day, sir!
Welcome everybody here to your Defense Season 4 coverage. I am TobiWan, bringing you one of our last games coming off from the group stages. Well, technically I can say, well, the group stages are over. They finished yesterday, and we are here in the tiebreaker from Group A. We already found out who our victor was in that third position for Group A. If you want to check the details, find them all over on the-defense.com, where you can watch the videos over on youtube.com/joinDOTA. But you can watch who will get the number one position, the winner's bracket semi-final slot. That is what is at stake right now. The loser of this match will have to go through the lower bracket of the playoff and have a harder run to the defense grand final. Who will it be? Let's find out together. They are two top-notch teams. Mousesports going up against Na'Vi. That is your matchup. No wonder they draw. These two teams of late have been equal in skill. Mousesports playing some amazing Dota. Na'Vi as well with their new lamp. They found their stride, and we'll see how much they will stride tonight. Joining me in my broadcast for all of this evening is my wonderful friend from America, the Capitalist. Welcome to the game.
Thank you, Toby. That was quite the fun we had. I mean, I don't know if you had fun.
I had a lot of fun, man, but you know, I'm going to have more fun with this. Na'Vi versus Megas.
Sorry, I gotta agree. This game is gonna be really exciting. Na'Vi versus Mousesports, two of my favorite teams to be seeing. And Na'Vi, they've been looking really, really strong. Earlier, I would say about 2 months ago, they were really faltering, and ever since they were kind of changing up their team and they were moving around a lot, they weren't looking as strong, but in the last 3 to 4 weeks, they've really picked it up. They've been taking on a lot of top teams and coming out on top pretty much every single time. Well, Mousesports, I mean, we've been watching a lot of Mousesports games, but this team has really been coming together ever since... you know, before the qualifiers, and then even afterward, they've just continued to dominate left and right.
Yeah, that they have, man. They've impressed everyone, and they've gone beyond what I think anybody really thought their potential could be to be one of the top contenders. Let's see how we're going with that draft, man. Chen and Wisp being banned out. Syndrome starting off with a Chen. Instantly, it's that we might want to sit back, we might want to try and find our farm. We go with the whole standard, give Black the farm, give him the space to do what he needs to do, but find really strong laning heroes at the same time. So Darkseer already picked up here, so Koitva, he's already got his fun hero that he'll get to play. And Na'Vi, they go with what's going to be standard for them. There's no reason for either of these teams to play outside the box. They're just going to play with their lineups they're comfortable with, they're solid with, and then execute it correctly. And that's what it's all going to come down to. Who can execute stronger? Who is the strongest team? Nikt Assassin and Gyro. Na'Vi's really going to be feeling very, very comfortable with that one. So that's the lineup they'll go with.
Yeah, both teams keeping their options open going into the draft. I'm interested to see whether or not we're going to see some more interesting pickups as we get into the second picking phase, just because of the fact that both these teams are really comfortable, really, really experienced teams on both sides. Na'Vi especially, just absolute veterans of the scene, top-notch players all around. And so with that kind of skill, you can draft pretty much anything, go for any sort of strategy, and make it work. While Syndrome, the recent addition to Mousesports, he has really made his team. I was talking about last night on my stream. I think he's one of those players who, while actually inside the game, his technical skill may not be the greatest. I don't think he's one of the top players on his team. He really brings that much more. He's such a valuable member on his team because he is such a good captain, such a good drafter, and his I always love watching his drafts. I think he pretty much I would say like 7 times out of 10 he comes out on top, which is really good for a drafter. So Syndrome's, again, they do really interesting strategies a lot. I'm not sure whether or not they're going to try and pull something out against this game against Na'Vi, or they're just going to go standard on both sides.
Well, knowing Syndrome, and if there's ever a big game, a riskful kind of thing, he will always go what is safe, what is standard. That's just Syndrome's way. And Poppy won't take risks either unless he really feels he's being pushed into it as far as like a strat which can't be beaten. Then he'll think outside the box. But both these captains, both Poppy and Syndrome, they both normally have a very logical way of approaching these style of games. You notice also Puppy, his logic was also intimidation. You saw how fast he banned out that Conqueror and that Animage. It was sending a very clear signal to Syndrome. Syndrome also wasn't wasting that much time. And the second The second, like, those two quick bans came out, he banned out the Visage, said, yep, instantly, I know, Nyx Assassin banning out the aggressive tri lane. I don't want Na'Vi to have that kind of nuke up their sleeve. We know what Kuro can do with that kind of stuff. So he bans out the Visage, and then he waits a long time on the ban, because he's stopping and saying, okay, is it just Puppy being Puppy, banning out his normal stuff? He has to double-check what he's doing, which he does do so, and keeps his options very much open. Darkseer, Jakiro, SD, it's the elements of what could be aggressive tri-lane, it could be defensive, it could be anything they want it to be. Bounty Hunter will be the pickup here from Na'Vi, so Funnik gets one of his older heroes, puts Dendi onto Puck. Gyro more than likely will be played by Havost. There could be a support, but normally with the Nyx Assassin, we're looking at some kind of Nuka or jungler to come up from Puppy, and we'll see what he does choose. If we go with Aline, if we go with Latrak, with such a lineup, I'm a little bit concerned because I'm getting connection problem again. There's been some issues with Steam today where people are dropping in and out all the time. I'm hoping it doesn't continue throughout this game, but I'm in again. I'm in again.
Cool. Yeah, I was about to say, if anything, that subscriber game showed like half the people ended up dropping. So Steam's definitely having some issues. They had some issues last night as well, as I recall. They had a maintenance going on where they dropped Steam entirely. But hopefully we'll get that fixed. Waiting on the fourth pickup from Mousesports. They've already got, wow, Alchemist. I'm not really that surprised. Mm-hmm. A hero that Black can really capitalize on the farm with and then be able to also be aggressive. You got the Shadow Demon, Jakiro, Alchemist set up. That's a very dangerous lane. Na'Vi, there's no way that I feel that they can really aggro try this. I mean, they've got Nyx Assassin, Gyrocopter. Those are two very, very strong tri-lane heroes. And Nyx Assassin can't really be targeted too much. Actually, he can. I mean, the Shadow Demon disrupting him, and then the Ice Path immediately, he won't be able to actually spike Carapace, follow up with the Alchemist stun, and mix in the extra damage from Shadow Demon, and that's pretty much instant hero down.
Do you notice that we have exactly the same lineup as Team Empire? Just to throw it out. Just to throw it out there. What was their mid-solo? Huh. Queen of Pain, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, let's see if we actually get Mousesports copying now Team Empire. Team Empire just became trendsetters in two games.
Well, I don't know about trendsetters. that's a pretty standard lineup nowadays, but like maybe a month ago, like, oh, an Alchemist pick, you know, but and I don't think they're going to go Queen of Pain here. Queen of Pain, you've got, he'd be going up against Puck, which is all right. I mean, you can still win that lane. It's just all about the individual player.
I would even say Skywrath Mage be the biggest thing in Mousesports lineup. They've used it a couple of times up against the Puck. Normally, though, it's been from a support kind of role for that extra disable. I'm wondering if Cinderin could even go something new and different and go for that Lion solo move, which I've been begging for. That way you got that Hex, the stun, and that huge amount of burst damage. I'm not quite sure if Fader's been practicing that, though. We'll see what he wants from middle lane. And we get Rubick as the final one here. So there's our support combinations. Puppy will be the Nyx. Rubick for Kuro. This is what we talked about. Puppy will not make and like, take any risks. The Bounty Hunter is the only thing a little bit out of line as opposed to like what would be normal. But for Funnik, it's actually quite normal. For all these players, all the heroes they're playing are very comfortable style heroes. It's the same with Mousesports. Jakiro and SD, there's going to be no issue whatsoever for Sindri. If Sindri's actually played both those heroes, the pass, he was filling the extra slot. Quaitfa, he's played many times in that Darkseer. Alchemist, I can't remember how many times Black has farmed up on an Alchemist, but it's definitely a hell of a lot. And then our last one for Fader. Do we go with full-on, like comfy chair, kind of comfort, never want to get up kind of thing? Cinderin's got to decide, and he goes with a DK up against the Puck.
Yeah, I really like this pick. I was going to say, I think they need something a little bit more aggressive, and tankiness is really the biggest issue, I feel. If they can survive through the burst of Puck being able to jump in with Nyx Assassin Bounty Hunter, they can't afford to be too squishy here. Up against a Bounty Hunter, because you know Funnik's going to be looking for those track kills, and that can really snowball against them. Gyrocopter being able to pick up a lot of farm, and then being able to come out as that big carry. Now you've got both Dragonite and Alchemist, who are both very, very good heroes versus a Gyrocopter. Tanky heroes who can stand up against his Rocket Barrage damage. Good heroes to lock a Gyrocopter down and output a lot of physical damage despite the BKB that he's probably going to be looking to pick up. So I really like this pickup as well as you've got a little bit of AoE once you start getting into level 11, now that you can actually level that up and still be able to push. You've got some good splash damage coming out of that Elder Dragon form mixed with the Fire Breath. That's going to combo really well with the Darkseer-Jakiro combo.
Well, let's run through our lineups right now, man, to see what lanes we do have. So it looks to be, as predicted for Mousesports, Black will be on the bottom lane as the Alchemist, but Cinderin as the Jakiro supporting him, and Passerine behind him. Middle lane solo, Fader as the Dragon Knight. Up towards the top lane, Koitva will be the Darkseer. And through Na'Vi, Kuro is Rubik play as the Kermit the Frog kind of build, except he's gone a little bit more Kermit Dracula kind of style with his outfit tonight. He'll be as the Rubik on the top lane. He'll be moving around with Puppy, who is taking the role as the next Assassin. Normally when he does this, there's always that mid harassment with Mana Burn early on to try and help this mid solo get the advantage. And then we look towards Havorst as always, hard carry kind of guy, takes the role as Gyro on the top lane, Dendi middle lane solo Puck, and that leaves our last but not least, Funic, who is starting a rather aggressive movement already, moving in behind the tower, and this is going to be holding up the creep wave a little bit. He'll take the, really, yes, in fact, he just waited for it to wear off, so he'll take the creep wave up, walk it himself. It doesn't matter if he doesn't pull this all the way back to his own lane, and the main thing he's searching for is for the lanes to double up.
Yeah, Mouse is grouping up here, and Funix put himself in a bad position. I feel that when he's
sentries, sentries, no nothing.
Oh, where's Jakiro?
Jakiro is off to the side. He was a little bit too far away to drop down the sentry. And he hasn't planted in the lane. And Cinderin's actually going to do a really good job now. He's going to pull it over. So 30-second mark, did he take the aggro? Oh, he missed it. He lost it. I thought he was going to actually keep the aggro with one of the Ursas, and it's not going to work. Or Hellbears. Now, you at least hold one melee creep there. But that's still going to be a creep wave and a half to push out through that bottom lane.
Funic really has to be careful. He can't really get close to this Alchemist at all, because if the two supports do spy him out, you've got a really long-term disable with that disruption. 2.5 seconds for Alchemist to wander over, mixed in with an ice path and instant lockdown. They've got some really good abilities to keep Bounty Hunter in place long enough for Alchemist to get in range with his stun. So he has to be exceptionally careful when he does come to lane here. But it looks like he's going to be able to pick up a lot of golden experience with this lane pushing in. Black is doing what he can, denying as much as possible, but there's only so much you can do when somebody pulls like that.
Speaking about denying something, middle lane, Fader, he just can't catch a break here. Every time he tries to come in, he just cannot let off his breathe fire. He thinks he can, tries to slow down Dendi, but right now it's 1-0 up against 9-1 in that middle lane. That mana burn has just shut Fader down so hard. He's having to wait long before he gets his bottle. Once his bottle is up, then he'll have a lot more to play around with in the middle lane. But then again, bottle's already there for Dendi. He's playing around too, being nice and aggressive, throwing the orbs up, and that fact is now his bottle. Just under 2 minutes, and it will come out in the Flying Courier.
Yeah. He's, Dragonite traditionally is a pretty good middle versus Puck with his spamming of breathe fire. He can do some decent harassment depending on, Puck's ability to be able to phase shift in time. But still, in the mid-game is really where he's important. Once he gets that Shadow Blade, he can really jump on that Puck and do a lot of damage. But right now, they're securing Dendi a nice early lead, which is really important. So well done by Poppy moving in and being the really obnoxious roaming support that he is.
Mm-hmm. Dendi's got to be careful not to overextend himself too much, though. Coming in range of that town multiple times. And FaZe got to send that courier back. Good thing he just waited for it to have the speed boost. But it does mean he's here with no mana whatsoever, so to leech as much experience as possible. And Puppy managed to find himself two friends. Holds him outside the tower, which means that Na'Vi control that middle lane again. This is such a rough time for Fader. They've got to do something about this, but like, what are you going to be doing? Jakiro can't rotate. He wants to pull, but Funic's been causing him a couple of issues with this one. Koitva had to abandon the top lane, so now he's managed to have himself a double stack over here. Is that going to be 18 HP, Dendi with DD.
I didn't think he was actually going to bring him that close, considering the armor from Dragonite, but a double damage just did some serious work. Like, I was just about to say, Dragonite, he has a survivability that he shouldn't worry about. Like, once this double damage fades, just the Nyx Assassin ganking won't be that big, but you also know Funic's going to be angling for a potential gank as well. So that's another problem Dragonite has to consider. The two supports may want to think about really trying to do gank middle eventually once they pick up level 3. The problem is they can't smoke, right? Funic's being interrupting the jungle constantly. He's actually level 3
Dendi
already.
He's actually going to get himself in here. One more attack, he needs vision. Fader went down to 12 HP, and Funic might see if he can snipe him off on the way back. He's at least got a chance for the courier if he comes up, but no, he's just sticking around Koitva instead, and he's going to block the pull point. Well, this is just frustrating for the Darkseer. And then he pops the salve as well. He's got enough mana to surge or one Iron Shell. He has to choose between the two of them. And Fnatic will now heal himself up, go back inside his invis. And the rotations come to the top lane. Puppy's up here with Kuro and Avorst. We kind of forget about Avorst just farming freely up here. When we watch the juking around of Fnatic. And Fnatic, wow, he's so close to bringing down Koitva. Pass, he's got disruption if he needs it. Bounty, not enough mana to actually get himself out of this one. He's short by 3 points. There goes your breathe fire. Deny himself the status. Yeah, he does.
Oh.
Neutrals just instantly blast him when he arrives.
Yeah, those disruption illusions made that those three targets that a Satyr needs to be able to throw out that orb. Really good play. Trying to deny himself. He knew he was going to be really, really close. He was either going to get that invis off, or he was going to have to deny himself. Either way, nicely done. Meanwhile, Na'Vi, they take a tier 1. And I can't believe the amount of experience and gold Fnatic has been getting. Just harassing the Darkseer and picking up those creeps.
Well, he managed, really to, well he managed to find a couple of the big ones too, like Darkseer when he was just having that Iron Shield going. Managed to bring down one of the big Hellbear smashes and just picked off a couple of other things. So yeah, finds the experience, finds the levels. At the same time, Black is still running 3 points, Grievel's Greed now hand of Midas. He is going to get big really, really fast. That's the reason why I think Na'Vi's so close here on the tier 2 tower in the top lane. Koitva's trying to hold him off, but they want to do as much damage to these tier 1 and tier 2 towers as possible. Restrict the movement areas of Black. Because right now, Black, on this bottom lane, his net worth, it is higher than that of the Gyro. And that's when they're a tower ahead as well.
Yeah. They know the two supports, they don't need to be anywhere near that bottom lane. That's an advantage of Alchemist. 1v1, he can survive through pretty much anything. So, Bounty Hunter being in that lane, there's no way the Bounty Hunter is going to be able to out-harass him. So, he's just going to focus on picking up CS when he can in this lane. He's actually going to grab a very, very early level 6. And once he has that, look to see a gank on middle. The supports rotating middle with Puck being able to throw down his ultimate and then the track gold as well. I think you're going to see an early rotation as soon as he hits level 6. He's just going to communicate to Puppy and to Kuroki. Rotate to middle, smoke up, do what you have to. We're going to shut down this Dragonite and get some early gold.
Well, they're actually rotating to the bottom lane. Mousesports to stop Bounty Hunter from doing that kind of stuff. So pass, and he'd have a sentry ward for this one. There goes your sentry, but he's out of range now. Back in the safety of the tower, Fnatic in a nice defensive position in the lane. Always hung on this little side here, on the other side of that line. Because the second he crosses that, he knows Mousesports can initiate, and he can't get back in range of the tier 1 tower. At least force Mousesports to take damage. Because that's when you can have heroes like Avorst and Koro TP themselves in and really just capitalize on the overextension. But these three heroes also on the top lane, having a great old time just pushing to the tier 2 tower. Koitva trying to defend again. Three levels up in the Iron Shell. He's going to be given some help by fake DKs who can pull the aggro down. No one initiates on them. It's just pulling the aggro away from the tower is the main thing. Because there's no Enchantress creeps, there's no Chant creeps, there's no nothing like this that allow the force of that tower to go.
Yeah. Well, they're rotating in middle already. They don't have the Bounty Hunter. He is in level 6, but still, it looks like they're just going to full-on dive, which might put themselves in a bad position if they have teleports. Black has a teleport. I'm not sure if any of the supports have him. Cinder
does.
Even
if they do, Fate is dead beforehand. And would you believe that's actually First Blood?
Wow.
Says 2-1 on the board. That's actually.
I was going to say First Blood earlier, but. Mm-hmm.
Sorry?
I was going to say Bounty Hunter, like when they were talking about that potential rotation of mid. I was going to say First Blood, but.
Oh, disruption pass picked up, throwing down. Havorce lets off the cooldown. He just wants to fight this one. Dendi's in the middle of this one. Sidran taking too much damage. And now the movement down. Dendi with the orb actually going to miss on pass, but at least lets him keep up with these two more attacks. Actually, only needs one. Had more damage than what we thought. Faze shifts off cooldown, so he can still able to evade his concoction once it flies, but with a TK stun, a follow-up concoction, they bring down the solo mid Dendi, and just before he had that blink dagger as well.
Good rotation all around by Mouse. They just needed to be ready for that sooner, I feel. If they'd been there before, like Dragonite's supposed to be this big tanky hero, but he just got mobbed down so quickly they couldn't even teleport in time. But yeah, this like they don't need to be in bottom, I feel. Like, they can be pulling and getting levels, but honestly, neither one of their supports is hugely level-dependent. Shadow Demon's pretty independent of levels. Disruption is his biggest thing. And Jakiro, you know, you like to be able to have levels, like to be able to max out those nukes and the ice path time. Mm-hmm. But it's much more important for Dragonite to be able to get that assured farm.
Yeah. Well, DK kind of wants to kill right now. Dendy's gonna be careful. And stick charges with that hit, extra hit. He ticks down very, very low. FaZe shifts, bottle charges up as fast as he can. And that was nicely played by Fader. He almost had a perfectly calculated, but he needed just that extra attack into Dendy to get the kill. And now on bottom lane, Funnik. I think he's thinking about Syndarin. I think he's thinking very, very strongly about Syndarin here. Attacks him, the track is still there, and he gets the kill. Solo hit, and he managed to bring him down right next to Black. But what's Black going to do? Concoct half a second and throw? It wouldn't have been enough control to stop Funnik from getting that.
Yeah, that was really, really bad. Having your offlaner being able to pick up a kill like that, a track kill on top of that, he is actually rolling in gold. He's got phase boots and another 1,500 gold. That's huge for an offlaner at 10 minutes in.
And Funnik just has to lap this up. Just keeps rolling with the punches. Plaque. He knows he can be chased so easily by Funnik as well, and Funnik with these phase boots, he hits decently. Not quite sure what Puppy wants to achieve here. He throws down an observer ward right next to Sentry and reveals the smoke. I don't think he knows he's on top of a sentry ward, however, he walks in with a spy carapace, was looking for the stun, the support coming in. Avorce on the way, but Puppy, well, he's definitely manned up right now. Avorce goes in, Puppy's still alive. Are you cracking kidding me? He gets away on 40 HP, the flat cannon damage, it's not going to be enough to kill off Koipa or Syndarin. Then Syndarin started to deward it off, and Havorce into the rocket barrage. Black is going to be here, and now as Havorce is overextended himself, Black looks for the target and he gets it. Full stun out with the Iron Shield damage from Darkseer, but in comes Dendy. He picks up Koipa already, and he jaunts himself up, but DK very quick on that stun, but Dendy still going to turn around, goes for the silence, picks up Syndarin. He's got a couple of fake versions of himself in here as well, but Darkseer's Iron Shell, still in death, does its work. And brings down Dendy, who's just searching and hunting for the kills. Now 4-2-1 for him.
Yeah, with those kills, Gyrocopters actually has higher gold per minute than Alchemist. Actually, they just evened up after a couple last hits. But they're doing a really good job with this aggression. But Black is still keeping up with that. Grievous Greed, he wasn't forced. This early aggression didn't force him to go Acid Spray early on. He still was able to get Grievous Greed, but they're taking a lot of towers, and that's a big part of this. Once Mouse is able to fight up against Na'Vi, once they have a high level on Black,
oh, Puppy, actually, again, go. Just so aggressive in the lanes. Pops a spy Carapace, and Denny is here with Blink Dagger, and Denny will just phase shift out the concoction. Puppy's coming back in again. He's going to stun, not attack first, though. So there's not enough damage, 100% to kill off Black, but he's worried about diving in too far again. With his Spy Carapace still on cooldown, he doesn't have a way out, and Denny get to blink himself away to safety if he wants to. Ice Path gonna catch him quickly, might have to phase shift, nice done, four on it, and then the orb hit all four as well, and Funnik, well, he wants a track out of this one. He's gonna find Cinder and he's the closest one, so there's your track. Stolen, it's actually gonna be the Dual Breath, and what a puck holding with the silence as well. Everyone gets the bonus bonus gold. Faded go down as well. Koipa, he also takes a fall at the end of that one. There's only one track kill out of all four, but it's still four deaths for Mousesports, and Funnik gives Black just a little bit of a gift in his back pocket. It's called a GPS tracker.
Yeah, like, Dendy's such a big playmaker in these areas. They were so grouped up, he was able to recognize that he can back off, and that early, early Blink Dagger is really playing into their hands now. They are just absolutely destroying Mouse. Now they're going to be able to pick up BKB on Gyrocopter. We may actually look and see early Tier 2s fall very, very soon.
That we may do, man. That we may do. But Na'Vi got to keep rolling with the punches for this. And I suppose the punches are getting stronger. When Denny's walking around with 1,500 gold up in that top lane, Havorst is now almost his BKB 13 minutes in. We have Funnik, who also, well, he spent money on buying up drums, Koro, Arcane Boots, and 500 gold. And he's so close to Koipa, can he pick him up from there? Yeah, he can. Drag him back, but Havorst, he can't pick him up the hill. So just give him a track instead, and Puppy with a track mover speed and Vendetta buff up. Damn, he moves fast. Sentry Ward reveal him, though, and then Fader stuns him up. Puppy now knows, obviously, very, very visible. So he gives a double stun. Denny to jump in. Orb damage plus that rift. It's already a 4-4. And he jaunts himself down. He brings down the SD. Puppy helped to get that first kill out. Now Dendy moving back at the same time. Stuns over on Fader. And this is spiraling completely out of control. Tracks are flying everywhere. And Dendy, well, he's going to fade. He's going to blink over the top of the Dual Breath, so he can keep going on Syndarin. He doesn't have enough mana for a Rift or Silence, but Koro, he stole the breath. Then he had to phase shift out the damage to the tower. He's going to die of the creep wave. Kill off by the Radiant side. So Dendi, powerful against heroes, but not against environment.
Apparently. Alka just picking up his Shadow Blade. That's going to be a decent, but honestly, Navi is so grouped up that unless he gets they get a really good vacuum unstable concoction, I don't see a whole lot of opportunity for Alchemist. He actually might be able to pick off Evos here. If he starts the unstable concoction, there it goes. Evos is low enough that he has BKB, but if he leads with that stun, he should be able to kill him.
There's the stun. BKB didn't go off. He could have let it go, but he decides to hold. And now Horvost, phase boots, movement speed, got 2-1 charges up his sleeve, and support's on the way. And I'm saying support for Mousesports. Fader, concoction, there's your BKB this time. Funnick moves around, and with that track bonus movement speed, DK's actually too far away. And he can't see Black inside the Shadow Blade. Horvost able to escape from this. That's going to be so frustrating for him. And Black also very lucky to get away once Dendi started rotating down. He realized Na'Vi would be coming over the hill.
Yeah, that's got to be so frustrating. That jump charge just gave him enough movement speed that there's no way, even with the Shadow Blade, that Black was going to be able to catch up. So, really well done again.
Oh, Dendi, wonderful blink. He blocked quite for in. The pass could not pass. They were locked. Locked in position. That would have been so much more amusing if pass was actually the Darkseer. I wasn't even thinking that, man. Afterthought. Anyway, unintentional pun, not so awesome. Funnick just keeps going with the tracks.
So Funnick's got Vlad's now. Like, he's huge, honestly.
Puppy. Dendi blinks him. He's got a DD rune up as well. Silence goes. They focus Cinder in the orb to back. And that also gets the kill on the SD. Fader being picked up. Cooldown's going to be there. Getting dropped inside the base. Black says, you know what? I got an AoE stun. And Kuro says, well, you know what? I got an AoE stun. Both concoct each other. And Black will go down. This control is almost completely gone now for Mousesports. In fact, Dendi with the DD rune is diving. We are 16 minutes in. And he's diving into the base. The phase shift disjoints the attacks. Koipa should be very, very careful still. And Dendi, phase shift. Oh, wow. Such great movement. He went BT's first item as well. 6-21, and Na'Vi are just 10,000 experience ahead and almost 14k worth of gold in front.
Yeah, this is really good to play by Na'Vi, because we always talk about this time where Alchemist is really, really strong. Same goes with Dragonite. They're supposed to come into the mid game about the same time. And really be able to control the map. Na'Vi, instead of waiting that out and letting Mouse be aggressive, and then once they have enough farm on Gyrocop to really be strong carry, then trying to take over the game, they just straight up said, you know what? We're not even going to let you finish up your levels to be a powerful hero. We're just going to get really, really aggressive early on.
Concoction's already coming. And they'll just go Cinderin. He's the easier one right now, but they split themselves up. And maybe they say, you know what, we can take both. Fader into dragon form, Cinderin goes down, Funnick takes him. Now they move over towards Fader, picked up, throwing down. That track just keeps popping out. Funnick with a double kill. And Na'Vi really rolling with the punches, looking very, very strong. I really thought this matchup would be a lot more even than what it is, but it just seems like Na'Vi's comfort zone is most definitely comfortable.
And this is... It's not even like Maus, when they pick up a certain item or anything, this is ever going to stop. They would need, like, BKB pickups as well as their regular attack damage items. Mm-hmm. Like, it almost looks like Dragonite's going to go for a very early armlet. He would need that and his BKB, and preferably level 16 before he could really turn things around. Black also really wants to be level 16. BKB would be nice on him. I mean, honestly, the Dendi's just doing so much work, they need to be able to stop some of that control that he's providing.
Yeah, but the only way to shut down Dendi is to make sure they get those stuns off on him, and that's not an easy thing to do. That's something which SD actually really fails at. The disruption buys more time for Dendi, speaking of which, now down the bottom lane, silence up on Black, he's in the Chemical Rage. Puppy's going to be here as well, Sentry Wars drop down just in case he wants a Shadow Blade, and he's just out of range of that Sentry Wars, had to throw a secondary one, and the dust from Koro. That's commitment. With a capital C. Well, Funnick and Kuro think about the top lane. Fader comes out, there's your call down, and they're finding him on top of the tier 3 tower. Rocket Barrage being held off the Centaur with the stomps. Ash doing good work right now, and Avorst, well, Fader gets the kill, track gold's there. Funnick able to one charge himself back up again, and then keep running away from the Iron Shell, but Shakiro's burn will finish him off. Now is Avorst who's in trouble. The Ice Path goes up the wall as well, so they get a copy of Avorst. That's a fight up against himself, but then Cinderin, one charges, can't keep him up. Flat Cannon hit, Koipa able to keep himself up and brings down the dominating spree of Gyro. Tuppy was about to jump in and avenge his fallen teammate, but decides against it. And throughout all of this too, Na'Vi has still managed to find themselves with a quad stack of Ancients.
Yeah, that's pretty ridiculous. Nyx Assassin and Rubick both have Blink Daggers. They picked them up at the same time. That's before 20 minutes in, both of your supports, your 4 and your 5, being able to pick up Blink Daggers. Mm-hmm. That just goes to show how dominating Na'Vi is at this point. They're almost sitting at about a 20,000 gold lead, about a 14,000 experience lead. That's monstrous. They can pretty much take Roshan at any time and push in and try and crack open the base. They may look at Roshan right now, actually, when Gyrocopter's back up.
I think Gyro will first want to pick up his... Well, actually, maybe he won't. There's a Yasha on him right now. I thought he might just go into the Demon Edge Monkey King, but there's too many creeps here. They've basically got to kill them all off right now. With the Vladimir's offering and the Life Steal from Avorst, this Ancient Sack is not going to take much time at all. So he's going to go from 270. 270 is how much gold he had when he started this, and he'll end with, after three Black Dragons, a decent amount. Also a reminder too, guys, this is the Defense Season 4. You're currently watching the playoffs. They're not too far away. There'll be more tiebreaker matches as well to be played out after DreamHack where you played. So keep your eyes over on the-defense.com as well as joinDOTA.com for the times for all those matches. And coming up after this, we'll be doing Star Ladder, the Star Ladder Season 6. Fnatic EU will be playing up against Alliance, and we will live stream that one out right here on this channel. So you won't have to go anywhere. Get to have yourself even more fun, Dota, tonight. Aegis Immortal now in hands of Na'Vi, in the hands of, specifically, Avorst.
Yep. This is what? Fnatic with AC, Jesus, he is just absolutely incredible. I mean, you would almost look at him and guess that he was a 1, by the way, that he is just so farmed. For an offlaner, 20 minutes in, to have all these regular items that you would see on Bounty Hunter, the Vlad's really is helping out Gyro's damage. Mm-hmm. Drums is really typical, and then an AC on top of that. He is going to be able to break open the base pretty quickly with that. Yeah. The physical damage, he's already helping out Havost a little bit with that. Because normal Gyro items, you don't usually get anything too big when it comes to damage early on. So that Vlad's is really helping out his flat cannon. Now you've got an Alpha Wolf on top of that.
Dandy, try to go on Black. Vacuum not going to work by Koifa. Dandy was still inside the phase shift, and Puppy will give him an Urn Charge so he can heal up and turn around. At the same time, this is all just smoke and mirrors. As long as they don't die, the advantage is better for Na'Vi as they take the tier 2 tower in the bottom lane, and Mousesports protected a lot of heroes up there to try and kill Dendi.
Yeah, they're pretty much just poking at them, distracting them from being able to take tower, and they can be really aggressive and even try and push into tier 3 here.
Oh, and Black. Blink up on Kuro, so he just picks him up, throws him down, steals the acid spray, returns it in his face, and now it's 8-27. TP supports coming to the bottom lane, Avorst straight into the BKB, can't control him, he just turns on the flat cannon, Cinderin, he melted, Denny will throw down the Omen Wish, they've got to stick around for the extra damage, Avorst with a double, Fnatic with a double, and GG well played. 22 minutes and 30 seconds is how long it took for Na'Vi to claim the number one position in Group A, which means they will take the winner's bracket semi-final slot. And they should be feeling very, very confident about that now. That was a very dominating game. So that will actually join IC Cup in the winner's bracket. In the winner's bracket semifinals. Team Liquid, they're still going to have their playoff against Kaipi and Team Dignitas. All three will advance through, but all three managed to draw themselves up in Group D. The Alliance is also in the winner's bracket semi-finals. So we'll see the matchups for those and how they all come out. And you'll have to check the details over on the-defense.com. That is going to be it for the defense for today. But as I said, stay tuned. We'll be coming up with Star Ladder action. Alliance will be playing up against Fnatic in about 24 minutes' time. That's obviously approximate timing. So make sure you stay tuned for that one. And follow Capitalist at Dota Capitalist over on Twitter. And myself, TobiWan_DOTA, over on Twitter. We keep you up to date with all the happenings that is our live streams, our Dota, our coverage. So make sure you definitely follow us there. And stay tuned. Cap, any last words for this game before we take a bit of a break, before we go to Star Ladder?
No, just Na'Vi's looking good, man. Boot camping has done them well, and they are just an absolutely dominating performance. Well-deserved win.
All right, guys, so short break, hopefully only just short, and we're back here with your Star Ladder coverage. Team Alliance going up against Fnatic EU, and we'll probably also do the KaiP game versus 4FC also at the end of the night. So stay tuned, we're back here for more Dota. The night's not over yet.
I said good day, sir!